So watch out. No, I'm just we're moving right along, and we're in Mark chapter 2 today. And for the next few weeks, or next several weeks, we're going to be in the book of Mark, just working our way through, just marching through Mark. And if you remember last week, we looked at Mark chapter 1 as kind of a resume for Jesus. Mark comes right in. He's a no-nonsense kind of writer. And he, instead of portraying Christ as a king coming into all of his glory, he's portrayed as a suffering king, as a suffering servant who comes to us. And so we see his actions speak louder than his pedigree or anything along that matter. And if you remember last time, towards the end of chapter 1, he healed a man in Galilee, and he told this man, go and provide the sacrifices that you were supposed to, provide for this kind of healing, and just don't tell anybody about this. And of course, what does the guy do? He goes and tells everybody. So we have this giant amount of people just following Jesus around, and it bothers Jesus of what he's trying to do. And might I bring up that I think what Jesus was trying to do was not necessarily to heal people physically. What he was trying to do was to preach the word of God. And if it so happens that he can help a few people physically, well, he was going to do that. But his word spread, it got to too much. So he went out into the desert and worked his way back up to his home base, which is Capernaum. And in Capernaum, or some people say Capernaum, in this area, this is where Peter was from. And Peter and his brother lived there with his mother. If you remember last week, Jesus went and healed Peter's mother. And so he finds himself back in his home base. And this is where we pick up today with, he can't go anywhere. And I also want to kind of say this. Just because there's a lot of people doesn't mean that there's a lot of spiritual health. And so I would say, where were these people when Jesus was being crucified? Where were these people when Jesus was in his darkest hour? Well, I'll tell you where they probably were. They were probably yelling for Barabbas to be let go. So these were fair weather fans. As a matter of fact, we can use that term. They were fans of Christ, not followers of Christ. And the amount of followers were much smaller. But as will become apparent, look at chapter 1, verse 45. Chapter 1, verse 45. So you're just backing up a verse from where we're starting today. And notice it says, yet he went out and began to proclaim it. That is the word of, or I'm sorry. He went out and spread the news with the result that Jesus could no longer enter a town openly, but he was left out in deserted places, and they would come to him from everywhere. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for your word. I pray that the focus of myself and every single person in here would be on your word this morning. That we would put all outside influences and thoughts out of our heads and out of our hearts, and that we would give you this next little bit amount of time. Help us to focus with a yearning and a desire to receive your message. Father, as presenter of this, of your word, I pray that you would give me the words that you would have me to say. Father, help me to say these things in a way that makes it perfectly clear. Remove myself from everything that I would say, and help me to just focus on your word. Help us, Lord, to draw closer to you and know what it is that you would have us to do. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So we're going to read, starting here in chapter 2, verse 1, all the way down through the first 12 verses. And I'm just going to read these and we'll go back and kind of walk through. It says, when he entered Capernaum, again after some days, it was reported that he was at home. So we don't know how long this was, but some days. Verse 2. So many people gathered together that there was no more room, not even in the doorway. And he was speaking the message to them. Then they came to him, bringing a paralytic, carried by four men. Since they were not able to bring him to Jesus because of the crowd, they removed the roof above where he was, and when they had broken through, they lowered the mat on which the paralytic was lying. Seeing their faith, Jesus told the paralytic, "Son, your sins are forgiven." But some of the scribes were sitting there thinking to themselves, "Why does he speak like this? He's blasphemy. Who can forgive sins but God alone?" Right away, Jesus understood in his spirit that they were thinking like this within themselves and said to them, "Why are you thinking these things in your hearts? Which is easier, to say to the paralytic, 'Your sins are forgiven,' or to say, 'Get up, pick up your mat, and walk'? But so you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins." He told the paralytic, "I tell you, get up, pick up your mat, and go home." Immediately, he got up, picked up the mat, and went out in front of everyone. As a result, they were all astounded and gave glory to God, saying, "We have never seen anything like this." There's a lot in here, and because of the way that we're moving through the book of Mark, we can't really dissect it all. But this is an incredible, incredible story of faith and healing. And so the first thing that I wanted to bring out is this idea of raise the roof. The message of the gospel is the number one need for humankind. The number one need isn't a good doctor, isn't a good lawyer, isn't a good car, isn't a good house, isn't good friendships. The number one need for humankind today is the message of salvation that is the gospel.
Amen.
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 And so, the best thing and the most loving thing, you heard the children talk about love today, the most loving thing that we can do for anyone is to bring them into the presence of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
He is our Lord and our Savior. He is the Lord and the Savior. And so, I quote J. Vernon McGee here. He says, "What we need more of today are people who are willing to carry those that they love to Jesus."
Amen.
We need to get on a corner of a, and I had it this morning, not a gurney, but a stretcher. We need to be stretcher bearers, not wait until we're pall bearers. We need to make sure that whatever it takes, by any means necessary, we will make an attempt to reach the lost in our lives for the glory of Jesus Christ. Philippians chapter 2, verses 3 through 4 says, "Do nothing out of rivalry or conceit, but in humility, consider others as more important than yourselves. Everyone should look out not only for his own interests, but also for the interests of others." We need to make sure that we're willing to, imagine this scene, pulling a man up on a stretcher to the roof of a house and pulling the roof back. And look what resulted in that. The faith of friends who have trusted in Christ to do whatever is necessary. Look at verse 5. It says, seeing their faith, Jesus told the paralytic, son, your sins are forgiven. Now let's not get confused. You can't do anything to get somebody saved. It's only a work of God.
Amen.
But you can get in on God's work. Mm-hmm. I draw your attention to James chapter 5, verse 16. It says, therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. And this next sentence is what I want us to meditate on. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. When you want to see somebody come to Christ, the first thing that you need to do is pray for them. The first thing that you need to do is humble yourself before a mighty God and say, Lord, I can't talk any sense into this person. Lord, I don't know what to say. I don't know what to do. As a matter of fact, I'm starting to believe that they're never going to come to a knowledge of Christ. But I know that you can bring them to that knowledge. Oh, how often I find myself just trying to talk sense into people or try to rationalize in my head what I need to do to get them to understand the message of salvation. And then a voice goes on, it comes on inside my spirit. And the voice says, well, did you pray for them? That makes a difference. It makes a huge, huge difference. Difference in the lives of our loved ones when we're praying for them. And as a matter of fact, it makes a big difference in the lives of those that would persecute us if we would only pray. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. And lucky for us, our righteousness doesn't come from our own selves.
Amen.
It comes only by trusting in the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
We would just humble ourselves and pray. One more thing that I would like to bring out of this section is that they were right. Only God can forgive sins. But they were wrong. He wasn't blaspheming because He is God. Only God can forgive sins. And Jesus had to go and show them that He had the ability to physically heal this man so that they might believe that He could spiritually heal this man. Remember, our number one need is for salvation, is for spiritual healing, for spiritual reunification with God Almighty. God is a holy God. He is so perfect that He can't come into the presence of anything that has any amount of sin. And so we need to hold that reverence up that Jesus, being God in the flesh, has the power to forgive us if we would just ask Him. If you notice the title of today's outline, it's Bring Them In. And we sang the song Bring Them In today. It wasn't an accident. It was on purpose. And so, not only do we need to raise the roof for people, do we need to go the extra mile? Do whatever it takes. What does that look like? You might have to give people rides. You might have to listen to people talk about the same thing you don't want to hear about anymore. You may have to tolerate with things that you can't necessarily tolerate. You may have to do a multitude of many things in order to reach each and every individual in your life. But we must do it. We must be stretcher bearers. But also, we need to get out there with them. We need to be a Matthew. Let's read from verse 13 through verse 17 in chapter 2 of Mark. Verse 13 through 17. It says, then Jesus went out again beside the sea. The whole crowd was coming to him, and he taught them. Notice that this is the theme in Jesus' life, that he wanted to teach them the word of God. People being healed was a byproduct of his ministry. It said the whole crowd was coming to him, and he taught them. Then moving on, he saw Levi, that is Matthew, the son of Alphaeus, sitting outside the tax office. And he said to him, follow me. So he got up and followed him. Now we move to the next scene, where we go to Levi's house. Just make note of that. And it says, while he was reclining at the table of Levi's house, or Matthew, the gospel writer, many tax collectors and sinners were also guests with Jesus and his disciples, because there were many who were following him. When the scribes of the Pharisees saw that he was eating with sinners and tax collectors, they asked his disciples, why does he eat with tax collectors and sinners? When Jesus heard this, he told them, those who are well don't need a doctor, but the sick do need one. I didn't come to call the righteous, but sinners. Notice that Matthew was saved by following the Lord Jesus Christ. And as a matter of fact, you're saved by the same salvation, by following the Lord Jesus Christ. When he calls us out, that we get up and go. And one of the very first things that Matthew did was he threw a party. He threw a party with the publicans, the tax collectors, the worst of the worst, and sinners. For what purpose? Well, I would guess that that purpose would be for them to meet his new friend Jesus, who had just changed his life. So we need to get out there. We need to step outside of ourselves and take the message of the gospel to people who need to hear the message of the gospel. Not people who have declared themselves righteous already by their own actions, or not even to those who have already heard the message of the gospel, but to those who have not heard the message of the gospel. And guess what? If you haven't heard and accepted the message of the gospel, you're a sinner.
Amen.
As a matter of fact, we're all sinners sitting here. We're just covered by the blood of Jesus, some of us.
Amen.
That is the heart of the gospel, that we have a need for a Savior. There is a need in our lives today for forgiveness from the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
So we are called to spread the gospel to those who don't know it. And Matthew sets a good example of something that we can do. Have a party. You know, there was a worldwide movement by Billy Graham, celebrating, starting at, probably his 90th birthday. So we're now doing the fifth year of this. And it's called My Hope America. And they actually, if you participate in My Hope America, they actually call you a Matthew. There's a training book that says Matthew Training. And this is the whole preface of it. You invite people over to your house. You make them some hors d'oeuvres or not. You show them a video by Billy Graham. It's a different one every year. They watch it. And then you get up in front of the television, in front of your friends, and you share your testimony with them. And then you offer an invitation. There have been people who have come to know the Lord Jesus Christ through this effort. But this isn't necessarily something that we only have to do in at the same time as the rest of the country. This is something that you can do whenever. And you don't have to have a party. You just have to talk to people. You just have to look people in the eye. You just have to wave at people. There is a world out there of lost people who don't know the Lord Jesus Christ, who are searching for something. They're searching for the love of God. And all we have to do is give them a little glimmer of that. Show them a little bit of compassion. A little bit of hope. And they'll receive that message. But what we need to tell them is that it's fellowship with Christ over religion. See, the world is very confused. Most of the time, when I ask the question, how do you go to heaven? People always start off by saying, well, I think you need to be a good person. I think you need to be involved in church. Folks, that stuff doesn't save you. If it did save you, there'd be a lot of people, a lot more people on the path to heaven. What saves us is having a fellowship, to communing with the Lord Jesus Christ. Not communion, but communing with Him is what saves us. Look at this, verse 18 through 22. Verse 18 through 22, this next story. It says, now John's disciples and the Pharisees were fasting. People came and asked him, that means that they were fasting at a prescribed time. So they were not fasting to get closer to God, they were fasting because everybody else was fasting. Kind of like today we have a lot of people who put Christmas trees up that don't believe in the virgin birth of Jesus Christ. They celebrate something just because it's the time of year to celebrate it, not because they truly believe. So don't get confused. They weren't fasting to draw themselves closer to God, or maybe John's disciples were, but really these people were fasting just because it was the day to fast, just because it was time to fast. And it says, why do John's disciples and Pharisees fast, but your disciples do not fast? And Jesus said to them, the wedding guests cannot fast while the groom is with them, can they? As long as they have the groom with them, they cannot fast. But the time will come when the groom is taken away from them, and they will fast in that day. And then he says this, no one sews a patch of unshrunk clothes to an old garment. Otherwise, the new patch pulls away from the old cloth, and the worst tear is made. And no one puts new wine into old wineskins. Otherwise, the wine will burst the skins, and the wine is lost as well as the skins. But the new wine is for fresh wineskins. So, the first point I want to bring up is that he's saying here, I've come to do something new. They were following the old letter of the law. And if we look at the world today, the world is still trying to follow the old letter of the law. If I'm just good enough, if I just go to church enough, if I just do whatever enough, But there's no I in Jesus.
Amen.
It's all about Him and what He did. And so Jesus came to do a new kind of work, not a work of, not a salvation by works, but a new kind of salvation, a salvation by trusting in His work. So, if I draw your attention to Romans 3:27, I was going to expound on this a little bit, but for the sake of time, let's just read what we have written. Where then is boasting? It is excluded. By what kind of law? By one of works? No, on the contrary, by a law of faith. We have now entered the age of grace. And grace is unmerited favor. That means that you get something that you don't deserve. You get something that Jesus did for you. There is no boasting in salvation because we're all in the same situation. We all have the same primary need, which is forgiveness. And God is the one who offers forgiveness to people. Why? Because we have transgressed against God. It's His law that we've broken. It's His world that we've brought sin into. And finally, to wrap up this chapter, we look at this section on the Sabbath day. And I'll just read it. It says, on the Sabbath, He was going through the grain fields, and His disciples began to make their way, picking some heads of grain, which is permissible in the book of Deuteronomy. It makes provisions for that, that if you're going through your neighbor's field, it says, go ahead, take some grapes if you're hungry. But just don't put them in a bucket and carry them off the property. And so it was legal for them to do this. And as a matter of fact, I don't believe that they were working, as they held that from sundown to sunup, all of Saturday, that you were to rest. And so the Pharisees said to Him, look, why are they doing what is not lawful on the Sabbath? And He says to them, have you never read what David and those who were with him did when he was in need and hungry? How he entered the house of God in the time of Abiathar, the high priest, and ate the sacred bread, which is not lawful for anyone to eat except the priests? And also gave some to his companions. Then He told them, and I love this, the Sabbath was made for man, and not man for the Sabbath. Therefore, the Son of Man is Lord even over the Sabbath. Notice He was not breaking the Sabbath law. He had maybe broken man's law. So what the Pharisees, let's get a picture of this. What the Pharisees did was, let's say that this is God's law here in the center of my Eastern Michigan notebook. The Pharisees built a hedge around God's law. So they say, well, we're not supposed to go to work on the Sabbath or do normal chores and things like that on the Sabbath. Well, the Pharisees said, well, we're not even going to basically get out of our chair on the Sabbath. So there's no way we can ever pass this hedge and come near to breaking God's law. What happened was that the hedge became the new law. And so they thought, well, if you're hungry and you're walking through the grain field and you pick some grains, then that's like you're working. Not like we would think. You know, we take a day off Sunday to worship the Lord. Many of you go out to dinner afterwards. Many of you do housework afterwards, get ready for the week. That doesn't mean that you're breaking the law of the Sabbath. going to work, maybe. Luckily for us, we don't have that same type of laws as we'll come to see, where we have to keep the law to the letter, where we have to keep the law to every certain degree. Because if we had that, I'll tell you, we failed miserably. But now, we have entered a time of a new covenant. We have entered a time, just like we saw before, that you don't take new wineskins or old wineskins and put in new wine, because the new wine will just rip the old wineskins apart. Or if you get a rip on your clothes and you tie a piece of new, sew a piece of new fabric on it, the minute you wash it, the new fabric's going to shrink and it'll pull all the stitches up. You can't put old with new. It just doesn't work. You know, it's like if you get in a car accident and you paint just the front quarter panel, it's going to look awful. Because there's going to be a little tiny piece where you can tell that it's new. If you want to paint your car, you got to paint the whole side of it. And you got to blend it in. And so Jesus was saying, I have come to do a new work. I have come to make a new law. I have come to make a new covenant. And this is what that covenant looks like. I think it's outlined beautifully in the book of Hebrews, chapter 4, verses 9 through 11. And this is the Sabbath that I strive to uphold. This is the Sabbath that I strive to maintain. This is my prayer that I live this Sabbath out in my life.
Hey.
And it says this. Therefore, the Sabbath rest remains for God's people. So there is a Sabbath for us. There is something that we need to do. Maybe we need to talk about what the word Sabbath means. The word Sabbath means rest. It means to take a rest, to take a break. This is what we do now. There's a Sabbath rest that remains for God's people. Now read this. For the person who has entered his rest has rested from his own works. Notice the first his is capitalized. Because a person who has entered God's rest, or the rest of Jesus Christ, has rested from his small h, that's your work, just as God did from his. Let us then make every effort to enter into that rest, or that Sabbath, so that no one will fall into the same pattern of disobedience as the Israelites did. They would repent and get back to God, and then their own selves would come back into the picture. When God's in control, things go good. When you're in control, things go bad. So my question is this to you today. Have you entered into that rest? You know, there is a promised land that's coming, just like the Israelites were going into the promised land. There's a promised land, heaven, that is coming. But there's also a promise that you can enter into now, and that's the rest of God. To enter into his rest, to rest in him, to cease from our own working, to cease from us doing it. I imagine what that day will be like when I stand before the Lord. And he might say to me, Steve, why should I let you in? I don't plan on saying, because as a pastor, Lord, because I did such good things in my life. My plan is to look at him and say, I trusted in Christ. I gave him my burdens. I gave my sin. I casted my cares upon him. I only trusted in Christ. That's all that I've ever had. The Bible says, the only good in me is Christ. The only good in us, in any human being, is the Christ in us. I mean, no, we can make it pretty. When I go to visit my father's grave, I walk into a mausoleum. When he died, he made me promise. He said, I don't want to be buried in the ground. So when he died, I found out that mausoleums really aren't that much more expensive than a grave plot. So I bought him a little plot inside a mausoleum, and I haven't went to his grave for quite some time because it still gets me. You know, get that little lump in my throat. It's the most interesting thing. I mean, this mausoleum is all marble. It's a concrete floor, and it looks really pretty. You know, there's a little section for each person. But you know what's behind that beautiful cover? Is death. It's a bunch of dead bodies with no life in them. And in a lot of ways, we're like that. We can make ourselves look real pretty on the outside. We can make people believe things that we want them to believe about us. But at the end of the day, we're just spiritually the walking dead. No hope. There's no hope for us on our own. There's no self-righteousness. The only hope that we have is in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And what he did on the cross. That he was born of a virgin. That he came into this world. That he taught and he suffered. That he died on the cross for our sins. That he was buried. That he was in the grave for 3 days. And then on that resurrection morning, he rose again to make a way for us. Rest in that. Don't rest in anything else, but rest in that. Because that's the only thing that saves us, and that's the only good in us. It's only good if it's from God. Anything else is tainted. It's only a matter of time before it starts to rot. But that of Christ is imperishable. So I challenge you today to enter into that rest. And if you're resting in that already, then I challenge you to be a Matthew, to be a cot carrier, to go out and seek and save the lost along with God. Because that's what his work's all about. Father, I thank you for this church.